Welcome, everyone. My name is Tepiso Aina. I'm just gonna wait a bit to wait for more participants to join us. Can you all hear me? I'll just see if the interpreter can hear me. Okay, you can hear me. Great. Just give it a moment for more participants to join in. So as soon as they have joined in, we will start with our presentation and also our session for today. Okay, let's just give it a minute and then we'll start soon.
Good morning, Nancy. Good morning. Yeah, I'm looking forward to listening to the attendees' journeys today. Very good, very good.
Okay, we are live now. Welcome, everyone. I thank you so much for joining us to part two of In Conversation with Sheena Jacobs and Nancy Roque. I'm so looking forward to today's session, and I also looking forward to all your participation today. It's exciting. It's just exciting to see everyone joining and having this conversation actually happening in our respective communities. So without any further ado, I'll just ask Sheena to move to the second slide of our session today. Just quickly, what to expect today. During the session, you will see the interpreters and the speakers appear on screen. You'll hear my voice as you hear it now, but you would not see me, just to increase access of sign language interpreters. All sign language interpreters will be spotlighted, but if you want to multi-pin, there's an option of multi-pinning everyone so that you can have, you know, multiple access of the speaker and the sign language interpreter. The Zoom feature, it's different, depends on your on how you are able to access Zoom. It varies from device to device. You can use different features, and also you can access those features using the buttons on the bottom of your screen. Live caption feature is also on, so you can just click on it and then I can give you permission to be able to access the live transcript. Next slide, please. Under the session tips quickly, this session is recorded for future use. Both your microphone and your cameras will be off, but then would appreciate at the end of the session to turn on your cameras, you know, just to see all your faces. And the reason for that is because we just want to amplify access. We know with Zoom, if you have all the cameras on, it's not easy for deaf people to access sign language interpreters because of all the cameras, you know, being on at the same time. So if you want to ask questions, or even if you know you want to encourage the speakers, or you enjoy the session today, or just to cheer, you can use the chat to do that. And also if you want to ask questions or comments, you can click on the hand raise feature because your cameras will be off. Please make sure that when you say a comment or when you ask a question, please don't sign too fast for the benefit of the sign language interpreters, and also do not speak too fast. Next slide, please. During this session today, as I would safely assume that everyone received the email from us preparing for this session today, that we are going to have breakaway session. So having breakaway session, would appreciate whenever we have discussion in that forum, you use the I statement instead of they or you. This is a safe space for everyone, and we want to make it as safe as possible. So the session is open to everyone, deaf, coders, hearing. So everyone is welcome in the session. As we know, we've said it before, objective is just to educate as much as we can. So we just want to ensure that everyone is safe. So quickly, if maybe you are triggered during the session, we would have a breakout room, and we also have an assistant counselor who you can have one-on-one session with them. And how can you do that? You can send a direct message to me, Tepiso, or you can send it to Sheena or Mandombi. Those are the three people that you can send a direct message to them, and then we can open up a breakout room. You'll be able to have a conversation with Ashley Stacy. So again, if you want to take a break, you're welcome to do so. Next slide, please. I'm going to start with the first presenter for today, Sheila Jacobs. She's a coder. She's been a therapist for 30 years and working on PADS work globally in the deaf and the coder community. Her main goal is all about working with our inner PADS and to ensure that our inner PADS work harmoniously. So I'm really looking forward to hearing her summarized presentation today. And the reason why we're having the summarized presentation is for the benefit of those who missed the first session. Next slide, please. And the second presenter is Nancy Roque. Her sign name is N3, which mainly stands for the primary colors that she uses, which is red, yellow, and blue. That's in a way her style that she uses in her paintings. She was born deaf to hearing parents, and they found out later that she was deaf at the age of 6. She grew up oral and learned American Sign Language in college. She's an enrolled member of Mesa Grande Band of Mission Indians from Kum Aye Nation in San Diego, California. She has a Master of Fine Arts, which she obtained from RIT in 1986. She has been a professional artist for over 30 years, and her main work is mainly about trauma art therapy in deaf schools, and also she's worked with coders since 2012. She is currently illustrating children's books, and she resides in Colorado. Next slide. The event sign language interpreters, we have South African Sign Language Interpreter, Natasha Maligo, and Marsan Nietlin, a second interpreter. Unfortunately, the interpreter was secure today. She can't make it to join us. So fortunately, we have another coder joining us today, Marsan Nietlin. And for American Sign Language Interpreters, we have Jenny Blake, Griselda Contreras, who will leave us in an hour, and Paulo Morales, they'll be teaming all of them. Next slide, please. Just to quickly to run onto the agenda, we will have the opening welcome, which I've just did now. And like I mentioned earlier on, for the benefit of those who did not attend the first session, we have a summary of the September 18 session, which will take about 35 minutes, and then we'll have a panel discussion. Panel discussion, we have four members, two deaf parents born to hearing parents, and two coders. They're just going to share their work that they have prepared since our last session. And that session is going to take 40 minutes. And then afterwards, our presenters will give breakout session expectations just to explain what will entail during the breakout session, and then for 10 minutes, and then the breakout session will take 30 minutes. After 30 minutes each group, we have four groups, will give a report back in the main session, and each group will be allocated 10 minutes to do that. And then when we're done, we'll have a reflection session where the presenters will reflect on what they've heard from the reporters, and then we wrap up in closure. And next slide. Okay. Okay, now it's a presentation. Thank you. Sheena, you can stop sharing the slides. I would now hand over to Sheila Jacobs to start with her presentation. And then after her presentation, we'll then go on to Nancy Roque also to do her presentation. And then we'll just allow 5 minutes of comments or questions. And then after, we'll then move to the panel discussion.
So I need to show from here. So I need to be co-host. Okay. Can you transfer?
Okay.
The host.
Okay, I'm doing that now.
Okay.
Okay, I've just made you a co-host.
So can you see the first slide of CODA and DEF together? Can you all see it?
Yes, we can see it.
Can I make that bigger?
Click on present on the top right next to share.
Where? Okay.
You see it? Mm-mm. On the right, you're almost there.
The Zoom or
no,
where?
It's on
it the says, PowerPoint.
Yeah, so it says yeah, it's like present next to that yellow button that says share. You'll just click on that.
Now I see it. Okay. So hello, good morning from California. My name is Sheila Jacobs. I'm going to be signing and talking, and it's the reason is because that's how I grew up at home. I had many deaf and hearing and hard of hearing relatives, and I often was interpreting for many different people in my family. And I work now as a family counselor, and it's really important when I meet people that we can feel at home together, of how we communicate at home here when we're discussing our families and backgrounds. So if there's any one that's not following me, please, like at home, just interrupt me. Sheila, please say that again. I'm happy to make sure we're all understanding each other. Is everyone okay? Interpreters, we have four interpreters. Okay, thumbs up. I can't see all of you, but I wanna make sure that the interpreters have their microphones on so I can hear you if you need to interrupt. And also Betty, the host, has her microphone on. She can interrupt me too. Okay?
Will do. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. So this beautiful artwork was made by a deaf friend of mine from a hearing family. The artist's name is Renee Rose. So she is a deaf mom with coded kids that have grown up. And this is a happy family. The goal is that we feel very close to each other. I was involved in the beginning of CODA way back 35 years ago. I met the founder of CODA. Her name is Millie Brother. Met her in 1984. She started CODA in fall 1983. So I was maybe 28 years old, 35 years ago, and many things have happened since. So I'm here to share my perspective, myself as a CODA, myself, I became a counselor for the last 30 years because I wanted to see happy families and successful CODAs and deaf people. So I'm gonna share my mental health perspective with you. Some of you missed the first webinar on September 18th, which happened to be my deaf mother's birthday. Happy birthday, Mom. And my mom passed away when I was 20 from cancer. I'm happy to say that my deaf sister is here, Lisa Jacobs from Delaware. Maybe can she say hi to everyone, if possible. Open your video, possibly. So the next slide. Now how, okay, so I would do it this way. There's my sister.
Hi there.
Can you introduce
yourself? Hi, good morning.
For a few minutes, please.
My apologies, I'm sorry. The
Can
slides
you introduce yourself a little bit?
Sure. So I'm Sheila's younger sister. My name's Lisa, and I'm deaf. And we're the ones in the family who live on the East Coast. Well, no, my apologies. I live in the East Coast, so it helps out being able to have the Zoom meeting here so we can all connect. And that way we're all able to support each other. So I'm here for a short moment.
Thank you. So now I'm struggling of how to do the next slide, why it's not working. So Sheena, can you help me, please? It's not moving to the next.
Okay, Sheila, if you can use the, there are two arrows. I'm not too sure what are you using at the moment. Okay, you have it now.
Well, I'm not, okay, so this, at the end of the first webinar, we gave fun homework because the first webinar was, I shared my journey, Nancy shared her journey, and the homework was to think about your journey, and today to come back with each other, we will have a panel of deaf and two CODAs and two deaf sharing their journeys after seeing our first webinar. Then we will have breakout groups that will give half hour for each of you to be able to share. It'll be short because we have 30 minutes, but we want to hear after the summaries of your experience in your groups, sharing your own journey. Remember, for today, it's each of you to look inside of yourself and think and feel comfortable, hopefully, to share and listen to other people's journey between many worlds, deaf world, hearing world, and sometimes very confusing, and CODA world, and a lot of misunderstandings. So the next slide. My journey led me to realize that there's four bilingual or multilingual identity groups. It's not just deaf hearing. Are deaf people the same? Hearing people the same? I realize there's four important different bilingual experiences or multilingual experiences in the four groups. The two deaf, deaf from deaf parents, deaf from hearing parents. So then hearing from deaf parents is different than hearing from hearing parents, because each of the four have different home and school and different languages used in different places at different times in your life. Deaf of deaf, born with signing, with deaf parents, already signing, already familiar with deaf life. It's very different than deaf from hearing family. Many deaf born to hearing families don't know what to do, not realize they have a deaf child. And often teachers or doctors tell them, don't sign, that's bad for your deaf child. So they stop, they don't learn to sign. Many deaf from hearing families learn sign language later, 5, 10, 20, when they go to college, like Nancy. So that causes a lot of complicated journeys. So hearing from deaf CODAs over 18, if you're under 18, it's KODA, kids of deaf adults. Become 18, we call them CODA, because the organization is for over 18, children of deaf adults. But many of us have hearing of hearing relatives, right? So deaf, if I'm deaf with hearing parents, I have hearing grandparents, hearing parents. I call them hearing of hearing. They have a different journey in that group, or hearing interpreters we work with, or hearing teachers, or hearing doctors. That's in the fourth group. So I will be explaining more about those later. Next slide. My goal is I want everyone to feel that you belong. You feel part of this community together. We're all equal. Not that you're above me or I'm above you. We're equal. And that's an important feeling when you want a healthy community. Remember, I got training as a counselor how to help individuals, couples, marriages, families, how to be healthy, how to have healthy self-esteem, So it's important to feel I'm a healthy person in a healthy community and going to a healthy school. That helps everyone to feel empowered. So, but the truth is many of us grew up in a divided world because, for example, I went to hearing school. Nobody signed there. My deaf sister went to oral school to start because my deaf parents wanted her to learn some oral skills that she didn't learn from home. My parents didn't have strong oral skills. Then my sister went to the school for the deaf, about 12 years old. And that happens to many deaf of deaf. I've seen that. So that divided world causes our families to often feel divided. Typically, you have in deaf with hearing family, the deaf child doesn't get sign language. The hearing parents listen to experts that say, no, don't sign. And they think I can't sign. I should to help my deaf child grow to be normal. So that causes the deaf child to feel left out, a lot of emotions, of course. And the hearing parents too. Often you see the hearing mom will take the deaf child to school and become the deaf parent who focuses one-to-one. Then the other parent, the father or mother, who's hearing often becomes taking care, the role to take care of the hearing sisters and brothers, kids. So the hearing parent responsible for the hearing kids often takes them to their hearing events, hearing soccer, hearing school, goes to the hearing school events, while often the mom hearing starts realizing to learn some signs or some home signs, or starts maybe learning ASL, is very excited, but the other hearing parent is busy working full time, taking care of the other children, often is tired, and many maybe have some conflicts about, you told me not to sign, now you're telling me to sign, and it's not easy for me to understand that ASL, I'm busy. So that leads to a divided family. So my goal is to help us to find more family-friendly events. So instead of me going to hearing events, my deaf sister goes to deaf events. It often causes us to live in separate worlds. So my goal is to set up signing family camps so that family counselors can support families with a wonderful staff that can share many tools every year, so that the families can meet other families while their kids are growing up and see families with older kids, grandkids, and then you have a wonderful new, I call it like assembly line of how to support our signing families. I have had the wonderful opportunity to be involved with different family camps in the last 30 years. Okay, the next slide. The next slide. So here's some art to show the different four identity groups, how they feel inside. So when I was traveling and presenting about the four groups, I would have a panel of four different identity represented on the panel. And then we met in four groups for each deaf of deaf family, deaf from hearing, hearing from deaf, hearing from hearing. And I would give out a piece of paper blank and ask them to express their inner experiences with their worlds and languages. And they're different parts and different experiences in the different worlds they live in. So here's a deaf of deaf artist named Betty Miller. In the pink paper, she painted her experience with different parts. So the orange is my deaf father. I will introduce my deaf father in a few minutes. He was a deaf leader in America and in California. Leo Jacobs, Leo. So this is his expression. So it says, happy in a cocoon, safe place, like the caterpillar then becomes a butterfly in safe place, cocoon, well protected from the sound and fury, could mean fury or loud, in the hearing world. So here is deaf from hearing family has a different experience in how they feel inside. That one simple drawing is very powerful summary of that person's life. They said that the big I is before they learn sign language. Growing up, understand lip reading, confused, emotional, disconnected communication problems. That was big I. So it shows their trauma. And when they found sign language later in life, this next part of their life, they could relax and see signing, follow conversation, feel happier, feel they could participate. In one drawing, this amazing, powerful drawing of one person deaf from hearing's whole life. This is another deaf of hearing person's drawing. So that deaf of hearing person expressed their experience, deaf heart. But the bags is hearing and oral. So the next slide. This is hearing of deaf identity. That's a coda or coda. But those codas have different way to express their experiences. So the river has a boat. The Coda woman was in the boat. Looking at the big city, the hearing world is big. Looking at the small town, the deaf world is small. And she writes, hidden. And she feels in the between the worlds. So this is a Coda man in southern United States, Mississippi. The first Coda was living in Maryland. Okay, so you see that the Coda says to the deaf door, love you. The hearing door, he doesn't sign love you. He signs peace for a reason. So the next is hearing of hearing identity. Next slide. So these are both nature. Hearing of hearing flowers says boyfriend, one flower, friends, class, work, dog. So the second one is a male from South Africa, hearing of hearing, who moved to America to work and worked with deaf. So he expressed it as a tree with roots, with many parts in the roots, the name. So I don't know if you can see them. So it says Christian, Jewish, deaf, hearing, work, leisure. And then right at the tree, it says family, friends, strong roots. Then it says poor, rich, white, black, South Africa, USA, Portugal. The next slide, please. So this is my large deaf family. It's my photo from graduating from high school. I was 18, 17 really. It's my deaf father, Jewish. His family was in California where I grew up. So my deaf father's first, the next is my deaf uncle. Next is my deaf aunt, his second wife. The next is the Coda son. My uncle's son is a Coda with the tie. Next to the red dress is a Coda cousin. Now my two Coda cousins communicate differently than me. They mostly fingerspelled. I could sign like deaf because I had a deaf sister, my mother deaf from deaf parents. My deaf uncle married wife Marie from a hearing family and had concerns about teaching signing ASL to her two hearing children. She tried to teach them to speak and fingerspell politely back in the day. They were not encouraged to sign like deaf. So that means when we got together for Christmas, Thanksgiving, I often was interpreting for many different relatives. Codas who fingerspell, I would sometimes interpret. And for their hearing kids, my cousins and my deaf sister is sitting on the deaf cousin, I mean the Coda cousin's wife. My sister with her old-fashioned hearing aids, you remember? And then sitting on the floor in the blue dress with hearing cousins. They are hearing of hearing. So that shows the different identities right there. You have deaf of deaf, two brothers, my father and uncle, both deaf from deaf parents. My grandparents all deaf. Then you have my Aunt Jo. She grew up oral, learned sign language later, and married and moved to California and joined a deaf of deaf family. Then you have the Codas, and you have K-O-D-A, and you have hearing of hearing cousins, daughter-in-law, etc. So that's the four of us. That's the last family photo. My mother is wearing a wig. It's a fake hair because she was very sick with cancer. So she got sick when I was 14. I was pulled to interpret for her going through the doctors. They thought she had 1 year to live, but she lived 5 years to help the two girls graduate from high school and go to college. And she died when I was 20. My sister was 18. Next slide. So my deaf uncle, his two Coda kids, his first wife, Marie, from hearing family, that my deaf uncle with my deaf grandparents. Next slide. This is my mother's family. My mother had no brothers and sisters because she was born in 1931 during the Depression. And my deaf grandmother, you see, was always disappointed. My deaf grandmother had four deaf brothers and grew up in the country in North Carolina. North Carolina on the East Coast. My deaf grandfather, George, his sign name was George because he spoke well, George. And George was from a large hearing family. So he married into a big deaf, of many deaf siblings family. And you see, my mother's cousin, first cousin is Max. My mother's name was Dorothy Maxine. Max was named after my mother by his father was brothers with my deaf grandmother and married Laureen Sims. Dr. Laureen Sims works at Gallaudet University now. She's chief bilingual officer there. So Laureen joined our family in the 1970s. This was the last time that my mother's family came to our home in California together before my mother passed away. And you see that Laureen and Max had three kids. Jed, deaf, he was young, I'm holding, he was maybe 3 or 4. This is Rosalie Tim, she's a famous, well-known actress, deaf actress. Rosalie is my sister, is holding, maybe is 2. And then Frank is only hearing in his family the same. We have a name, only hearing coda. O-H coda means we have big deaf family and have all deaf sisters and brothers. We're in a small percent. Most codas from hearing families to deaf parents and hearing coda siblings, or maybe only child, or maybe divorced, have step siblings, you know, there's adopted, there's different backgrounds, of course. Next slide. So I'm the oldest of 2. I grew up in Oakland, California. Now remember, all of you, it's really important to know where you're from, what year you were born, your experiences with deaf hearing worlds impact your journey. So this is my journey, and we are not the same. We have many reasons to be diverse all over the world, and even in one city here, San Francisco, there's a lot of diversity for different reasons. And that's an important way we have to show respect for each other to feel that we're all equal. Next. So my mother graduated the North Carolina School for the Deaf, and then she met my dad at Gallaudet and moved to California. So I flew to North Carolina with my sister and my family to visit deaf grandparents and their deaf friends growing up. Next. So my deaf father, well known, wrote a book, Deaf Adult Speaks Out. That book you can look at Gallaudet University Press, look at online. Many deaf leaders tell me that that book he wrote in the 1970s is still true today. It's probably one of the first books written about deaf education from a deaf teacher's point of view. Next slide. He was the first recipient of a special position, chair of deaf studies at Gallaudet. So he was invited to Gallaudet to be visiting professor for 1 year. So his book really made a lot of revolutionary. It was a new perspective about deaf education from deaf families' point of view. So this is my deaf grandfather. He's also a leader. Back in the day, he helped found California Association of the Deaf in 1906. He was a printer, and he wanted to make sure to communicate with deaf community in California using newsletter that he printed and sent out. reason is because he wanted to see better deaf education for his two sons. My uncle born in 1909, my deaf father born in 1918. This is our family. My mother, father would send out Christmas cards every year. This is one Christmas card photo. And this is to focus on my mom's background. And she was the first deaf teacher in Oakland schools. After it was oral, no sign language allowed. Then they permitted sign language. So they hired my mom to be the first deaf signing classroom teacher in Oakland. She taught many inner city Black deaf students from Black hearing families that didn't sign much. And she would bring her students to our home, deaf home, to show them what a deaf home looks like with the doorbell lights, the old TTY, and how they can look forward to having their deaf home in the future and to show that deaf can. Next slide. My deaf sister, who's here, was National Outreach Director before she retired 2019. Now lives in Delaware with her deaf husband. And I can't read all that it says. She just became a grandma, so my CODA niece, Darby, just had her first son, 2021, May 17th. So my deaf sister's now a grandma. We call her Nana. So congratulations to my sister for her first grandchild. I was lucky to go visit them this last summer with my son, my second son, Nicholas. My first son, Ryan, was here talking and sharing his experience as a GODA, grandchild of deaf parents, last time, September 18th. So my sister and I had not gone to North Carolina for 30 years after my mom passed away, age 46, my deaf grandparents passed away. We didn't know the hearing cousins well. They didn't sign, so didn't go except for once. We went when Darby was little to one family reunion, and then nothing. And then I realized my second son, Nicholas, was with me in Virginia, where my niece lives. North Carolina's right next door. I must bring my son, but who and how to meet? So we had like a family reunion. My deaf sister, my deaf brother-in-law, the two of us, the four of us went, and we joined one first cousin of my mother, hearing, in his 70s. We joined them for 3 nights, and we felt finally bonded for the first time. I'm now 63. I almost refused to go to North Carolina. Why? They're all hearing. They never learned to sign. I never knew them well, didn't see them often. But now we connected, and that's what I'm hoping a family camp can do, a signing family camp that you invite all your relatives can learn to sign in a fun way with the right staff and curriculum. Next slide. So deaf and hearing sisters and brothers can enjoy each other and can communicate with the right support. So I helped, my sister and I founded the first deaf and hearing siblings retreat in 2011, I believe. And then we had 3 summers of deaf and hearing siblings together over 18 to help build more communication, more fun. And it was very, very exciting to see something new to support deaf with their hearing siblings. Next. So my dream is global family camps. Why? To help all 5 generations in our families become strong together. What do I mean, 5 generations? Let me show you. Next slide. Well, first, I'm going to explain. I mentioned I met Millie's brother in 1984. That's how I got involved with CODA, became active and helped put on the first CODA conference with 100 CODAs coming. Back in the day, it was open. My deaf father joined that conference, and other deaf parents and other hearing spouses and family and hearing from hearing families who maybe wanted to learn more. It was open in the beginning. The next CODA conference will be in South Korea 2023. Next slide. So the five generations, I will show you diagrams so you understand. And for you who came on September 18th, this is a good review. And then remember, we will be having a panel and having groups. So I'm trying to check my time.
We are about over time now. So we have about 5 minutes on your side.
Okay.
Wrap up. Thank you.
Okay. So the next slide, please. Next one. So this shows the three generations. You have deaf child with hearing siblings. The next is a hearing mother, hearing father for 90% of the deaf community. And above that are the four hearing grandparents. Often you hear in deaf education, people talk about hearing parents, hearing parents, hearing parents. Often, but I believe the hearing siblings are maybe more important because they're the same age, they're young, and if you give them signing and sign language early, they can grow up signing. The parents already have many years of speaking. If they have already two hearing children, they're used to talking. If the third baby is deaf, that's the biggest challenge for that family, because siblings have important impact on the family communication. If the first child in the hearing family is deaf, it's very different. The two hearing parents are having their first child deaf, then they modify their communication to fit that deaf child. Then you have a deaf oldest with maybe two hearing siblings, then they grow up with deaf already in the family. The parents have already made adjustments. So really, siblings are very important that often are not discussed. So the siblings will be the ones with the deaf child growing up. The hearing grandparents pass away, the hearing parents pass away. Then the hearing siblings are very important. The hearing siblings comfortable signing all the way and teaching their hearing children, the hearing cousins, to the CODA and CODA cousins, so the whole family can communicate ongoing. So this shows three generations: deaf, hearing parents, and hearing grandparents. You want to understand why hearing parents made their decisions about using signage. You have to understand the hearing grandparents. The hearing grandparents raised them, and they took in attitudes and experiences from their hearing grandparents affected hearing parents' decisions. There's two family trees, the father and mother, and sometimes the two families have opposite opinions using sign language. That causes a lot of family stress. So I'm a family counselor. I'm trying to explain why you have a diversity of different communication experiences. So the next slide. So the deaf child becomes a teenager. The next slide becomes adult, young adult, single, then finds, gets married, the next slide. Then they have the CODA kids. Most deaf parents are the same background. Deaf, one in a hearing family. So This is deaf with hearing parents, grandparents, meets another the same background. Then these two get married. And they give birth to hearing children, most are CODAs, grow up to become CODA and tend to marry or partner or live with hearing partners. Next slide. So now a CODA is with hearing and has the GODAs, grandchildren of deaf adults. We call GODAs. That's the five generations. The deaf is in the middle, two hearing generations before, two hearing generations after. So how can we support all five generations in our families worldwide is what I'm really looking forward to talking about. Signing family camps annually, I think, is the best, easiest, fastest way to start supporting signing families for a lifetime. So this is my two GODAs. They're grown 22 and 19. Next slide. So the goal is we want to have all four identity groups to feel sewn together like a beautiful quilt. We all belong. We all should be proud of our background and how we can support each other. Next. The homework that we asked you last meeting on September 18th to now think about your journeys and you look back, if I'm 60, you can start to think of 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, and 10 years, you can think about your journey and what's the name of your book so far. What will you call your life theme? It's different ways to think about your journey. The second, you can put pictures of your different languages and cultures or communities and start to analyze yourself and see where is the balance, where's the conflict, how I can help to feel better inside by looking for better balance with your different roles. I'm a mother, I'm a person, I'm a wife, now I'm an ex-wife. I used to be a sign language interpreter, now I'm a counselor. I have different things that are different parts of my identity, same as you too. Next. So the summary here is I started learning more about myself when I met Millie Brother, the founder of CODA. She completely changed my life with her beautiful vision. Her vision wanted to see, hearing from deaf parents, where can we meet? Many of us grow up with a family, graduate, go to work, or move. We don't see each other. Like deaf people in the deaf community can get together, maybe school reunions, deaf events. So she set up CODA to keep us connected. That led to annual conferences. I've been a CODA counselor since 1990, counseling for 30 years. And my goal is to see a better future with a better system to support signing families. And that's where I believe signing family counselors were trained to handle many different kinds of families. Teachers are not trained to be family counselors. Teachers follow the education, special education, and hearing education. The hearing children have a first language at home. They go to school to learn maybe second language or third language, but it's deaf children who are deprived of their language. Language deprivation syndrome is what we call that in the psychology and deaf studies field. So that is very unique, and I believe family counselors can work with teachers to help our families sign and be happier for the rest of their lives if they can go every year with many families and a wonderful staff to teach how to continue communicating and make it fun. So that's, I'll stop here, and we're going to have the panel, and we're going to go to Nancy next. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much, Sheila, for that presentation. Judging from time, we won't have a slot for questions, so I'm just going to hand over to Nancy now to do her presentation. Sheena, can you please share Nancy's presentation? Thank you.
Okay, hold on just a second. Perfect.
Thank you. Next slide. My name is Nancy Wark. I live in Colorado. I was born deaf. My parents did not know I was deaf until the age of 6. So I developed language late, was considered late. So language deprivation affected me. I went to an oral school for the deaf. I did not come into sign language until I entered my college career. So it was in college where I got my master's in MFA. I became a professional artist. I am the founder of Devia, which means for deaf art and artwork based on the deaf experience and the CODA experience. You have authentic works from deaf and CODA artists that show their vision of what their art and artistry means when, as it relates to the deaf world and their experience in the deaf world. I also have seminars for teachers to develop curriculum, lesson plans, and assignments for children and students to make art. I have attended several deaf schools throughout the US and public schools with mainstream programs. And I have worked with children of all ages and adults on projects such as murals, like the ones you see here on the slide. I also started art trauma therapy services for deaf, hard of hearing, CODAs back in 2012. So I have traveled throughout the US and a few places abroad. I had several residencies where I've taught art and art trauma therapy. I have illustrated 3 children's books. On this slide, you will see an example of an exhibit put on by the Ohio School for the Deaf, students that shared their trauma with their school experience, specifically school counselors. Many of the students were afraid to share their experience, but it was through art that they were able to share some of that trauma. So this exhibition highlights all of the work of the students. There's a counselor standing off to the far left. And you see a child there sharing their artwork and what it means to them. Over 300 deaf students made these paintings based on their own traumas, their lived traumas. Again, these are students from the deaf school in Ohio. There's a picture off to the far right. It's a question mark that was made by a deaf blind student. This was at the School for the Deaf in Fremont, California. Now, there are some students that don't share specific traumas, and it's something to mention because some of these students come from deaf families. So they have a different experience to share through their art. This student artwork is from California. This person did not sign in the home. And the message for the student was, "I am not important." These are the students that participated in the art seminar at the Fremont School for the Deaf. These are students in the Mississippi School for the Deaf in Jackson, Mississippi. 97% of the student demographic is Black students. They do not have an active art program. They really have a desire to express themselves through art and are in desperate need of an art program. They have a lived experience that's full of trauma and that they were able to share through their artwork. The artwork also includes First Nation deaf students that are based in Canada. They were able to share their trauma. That they experienced while living in reservations. This was a senior student that was a First Nation student, Indigenous student in Canada, and they shared what their journey has been in terms of their lived experience. They felt that it was a big burden to just go through this life as a deaf Indigenous person. There's a lot oppression that manifested in many ways, and the words are written on the rock to show literally the burden and the weight of oppression. This is artwork from CODIS. And they share their experience through art. And actually asked me to represent that experience through my own art. So I painted the following slides. So some CODIS felt that they were between two worlds, the deaf world and the hearing world, and they were in that borderland. I do have some published material. If you are interested, this is the website where you can view all my published material for purchase. When we first met on September 18th, part of the homework was to sketch some ideas, to grab anything, crayons, colored pencils, markers, and then just start a sketch. So if you didn't have anything fancy, at crayons, markers would do, pencils. You also needed a sheet of paper, white paper, and red, white, blue, black colors have a theme and play a theme in the work that I do. So yellow represents hope for the future and optimism for change. Red is powerful. Blue is oppression. And black and white have no meaning. It's just a way to make a contrast to the colors. It keeps a balance between the yellow, blue, and the black so that you're able to distinguish the contrast. Take it away, Sheena.
So we're ready to introduce the panelists.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much, Nancy and Sheena, for those review. And I just hope the people who missed the first presentation have a picture of really what was the first session all about. So without any waste of time, now we are going to move to the panelists. So if Sheena, can you just promote the panelists, the participants to the panelist platform, and the camera should be on and we can start with the panel discussion. They're just going to share the work that they've prepared since all of them attended the first session. And as you can see, all of the names are here, which countries they are from. And I'm just going to take 30 minutes. So Sheena, can you promote them, please? Can you see all the panelists? Bumi, Annette, Mandombi, and Mpo. I don't think Mpo is here. She's having issues with internet. So we'll have Bumi, Mandombi, and Annette. Over to you, Sheena. 30 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to be helping with the panel, And then Nancy will be adding her art experiences and helping talk about ways to express your journey. So first is Bumi, and then I'm not sure how to, Annette, are deaf from hearing families, and then Mantobi is a Coda from South Africa. All are from South Africa. We're supposed to have two deaf, two Codas, but one had some conflicts pop up. So Bumi, can you share for 5 minutes your journey, and maybe I will ask some questions. We need to reduce from 10 minutes each. Now we're reducing it to 7 minutes each, so then we have enough time for the groups. And Bumi and Nancy will be running the deaf group, and I will be running a group for hearing from hearing and hearing from deaf Codas, both with me. And then Betty will be running a Coda group, and Ashley is a licensed Coda counselor. Happy to have her. We don't have many professional counselors. I hope to see more Codas and deaf too become counselors. We need more. So Ashley will be running a Coda group right after this. So Bumi, please start your journey after you saw our meeting September 18th. You've been thinking since you saw the first PowerPoints. What have you been thinking about your journey?
Okay.
Spotlight. Let's spotlight Bumi if possible. Spotlight.
They are all spotlighted. Sheena, can you stop share screen?
Oh, yeah. Stop
PowerPoint. So we can see this. Can we see Bumi like as the speaker to come forward? Okay.
Okay.
Hi, Ada.
Hi. Can you guys see me clearly? Okay, awesome. Okay, so hello, everyone. I am excited to be here with you guys. And good to see you guys again as well.
Atta.
So from our last meeting, I definitely was in my thoughts, and it was a heavy question for me to have that discussion of my journey and to be breaking apart, breaking it down to 10 different, to 3 different decades. And to be able to, there's a lot of positive experiences and some negative experiences that there's some that I don't want to share, but the first 10 years, yes, I became deaf when I was 8, and I went, and that was when my life had turned upside down. I should have went, directly to a deaf path, but I didn't. I went into a different culture, and meaning that I had to let go from my hearing life and my hearing culture altogether. And I went into the deaf culture, but that transition, it was not smooth at all. I kept swaying back and forth, and it was in different paths and different emotions. So it was challenging. It was challenging. And
very, very challenging.
Yeah. And when I got to where I was, that's when, I accepted who I am. And then that was when I was able to grow. So that was my first 10 years. And then my second decade, I was in denial. I was still in denial. So I wasn't until in my 20s is when I saw things that were happening. So my family experience was positive. I had a good educated family. My father had a PhD.
Wisconsin?
From Wisconsin. So then we had moved here to Wisconsin. And because there was no education that we had back home, so we brought it here. So I was able to be brought here to the US. And then that was my first exposure here in Wisconsin with the deaf community. So I thought I was the only one when I was a child until I came out here. Then I realized, wow, there's deaf adults. And that was the first time that I had met a deaf adult. Then I had the realization, like, okay, then yes, I will be able to have the same future. And there was this woman who I met, and her name was Iva Ila, and her son's Dakota.
Ekloff,
thank you.
Son is Dave Ekloff.
So that was the first person who had set up Deaf International. Code International, thank you. And here's the picture.
She was a teacher.
So that was my experience. Well, I'm not done yet. But at that time, I had the realization. Oh, my apologies. Now it's on to the next person. So before we go.
You had a hearing of hearing life. It's very, very important.
Yes, I did.
Many deaf like you who become deaf while growing up, they start with hearing of hearing identity. It's a big part of your who you are. Then become deaf and have a lot of negative experiences. You don't see where the role models and no sign language and communication. So how? So that's very important that you started hearing of hearing. Then the conflict, upset, of course, you lost your hearing and lost access to many, your family members, many things. It's very, very difficult. But often people who go through that don't get enough emotional support during that time, so that you care. Many of people carry the pain and frustration and anger and many different feelings. To then you met like your superhero deaf teacher, you know, show you what deaf adults can do. Then you can feel, I can do it. So you have different parts of your emotions. Normal hearing person growing up, and your dad's very successful leader. You grew up in a successful family. Then challenge how and can't alone, where's explanation, lot of communication problems in that. Then you meet signing deaf, became your superhero. Then I have superhero skills, signing like her. I can. But that's a big journey. Like Nancy shared with me, she met her first deaf teacher, you 15, when deaf teacher came for 2 weeks in her school mainstream, and then stopped, disappeared. And then Gallaudet met deaf community, culture shock. So those are very important part of your experiences I want to acknowledge from mental health point of view. And I think the schools often don't do enough to support people like yourself. Expect you just go ahead, sign, no big deal, because they grew up deaf. It's very different. Okay, so Annette, you ready? for your turn. About 5 minutes. Our time is running about 5 minutes. Okay.
Good day, everybody. I'm so glad to see you. My sign name is Annette, or rather my name is Atta, and my surname is Haynes. I usually use a two-handed alphabet, but I'll try with a one-handed alphabet. I am married in the deaf world and living in the hearing world, where I had to learn an oral system of communication, mainly focused on Afrikaans, which is the language that I was taught, the written language that I was taught. I was born in a deaf family. My daughter, let me just find a picture here. My firstborn over here. Then my secondborn is over here. I have two deaf daughters and they are both married in a deaf family and they all sign at home. I went to Australia for the World Federation of the Deaf conference and I felt so empowered. And when I came back after that conference, I made friends with TMF and I basically fell in love with the group. And I absolutely love the people I work with there. It's nice to work with deaf people as deaf people, looking at our own needs. And now with the CODA project as well, very excited. I'm also part of the Western Cape Language Committee, where we look after languages in the whole province, not the whole of South Africa, only one of the 9 provinces. That's the Western Cape. And I'm part of the Advocacy Committee. I also work a lot with Tepiso, and it's fantastic to work with her. Thank you so much for listening to my journey.
Mute it, Sheila.
Sorry. So you're deaf from deaf family. Your parents both deaf?
No, I was born deaf and my family was hearing. I married into a deaf world.
So your husband is deaf from deaf parents? And yourself from hearing yes. Family.
My husband and his and all the generations from his family, 4 generations actually.
So 4. The same as my brother-in-law married my deaf sister, my brother-in-law from hearing family, and my deaf aunt from hearing family married my deaf uncle. So I understand, but it's like you have different backgrounds. So when deaf of deaf goes to deaf of hearing family, often deaf of deaf shocked communication is limited. If deaf of hearing goes to with deaf of deaf family events, enjoy more communication than I grew up with. So you have different experience, different chapter in your book of your life, different part.
Sometimes it could just be a movie.
And sometimes not all understand how to connect.
So many emotions.
That's my work, is teaching how the different parts can look, support each other instead of yes, no, that wrong, that right, oral, signing, which. So you know, learn how the inside different identities you have different times can become a team all together supporting each other, making plans. If you're frustrated, to use your inside team to discuss what to do, ideas, and not criticize each other. Then you feel so the goal.
That's very true. And I must say, that's why I am, you know, working towards having South African Sign Language as an official language, because then truly my identity will find its place.
Awesome. Thank you. The next panelist is Mantobi. Thank you. Look forward to talking more later.
It's afternoon here in South Africa, 25 to 5 p.m. So good afternoon, and to all of you that side, good day. I think it's during the day. How are you all? and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Sheena, for the lovely presentation, as well as Nancy. Thank you so much. Oh, our assignment, a bit difficult, emotional, you know, with a little bit of goosebumps. But anyway, I feel like I'm caught between two cultures, you know, deaf family and hearing family. My parents are deaf. My mom and my father are deaf. My father became deaf between the age of 1 and 6 months and 2 due to meningitis. And then my mother as well, she became ill. They say that when she was about 3, she became a baby again. So we don't know if it's meningitis, but she became ill as well and became deaf. So they both went to deaf schools and deaf club, like different schools. My mom went to Kutlwanong School for the Deaf, and my father went to East London School for the Deaf, Efati or Mfati, yes. So that makes me a coder, and that makes my elder brother a coder and my younger brother a coder. So the chapters that I'm caught between 0 and 10 years, it was very confusing with anger and reserved, very, very confused. And at some point, myself and my brother, we felt that our parents, they were at some point, you know, reserving us from hearing children, because some of the hearing kids, they would, you know, make fun of our parents, you know, try to symbolize the way that they talk or vocab the way that they talk. And that, you know, will make us feel somehow. And our parents, they taught us to reserve ourselves from hearing, you know, children, to play with other kids. So between 11 and 20, there's been a little bit of a shame in, you know, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, reserved as well. You know, we couldn't, you know, go along with other kids. Some of the teenagers at that point, they thought that we were deaf, because, you know, even though we are amongst those children, we you know, we're not that vocal. Spending more time with the parents, you know, try to break the communication, you know, break down within, you know, family gatherings or whatever the case that we will be, you know, going to stores and all stuff like that. And between 16, 18, 20, there's been some understanding and acceptance and knowing the identity of my roots, of our roots, where do we come from? And became, you know, understanding of who we are, a little bit of reserved, you know, started to grow up, you know, a little bit of confidence a little bit of understanding other kids as well, but knowing our background. So there's been some, learning development of decision-making. Even there's been some resentment there. And as we grew up, we met some of the deaf, children, which is the children of our parents, friends, And there, there's, some sign language interpreters or sign language, assistance to parents, and that made us friends with those, other brotherhood and sisterhood, and the profession as well. And one of the people that I can mention, of course, Tebiso, of course, Mpo, who's no longer with us, she passed on, may her soul rest in peace. Those are the other coders that, made us, understand our roots, our background, and understand where we come from with the knowledge that they had or they are having there. Age 21, 30, there was a light, there was a great light. There was a passion, you became joy when you are with this sisterhood and brotherhood and deaf, and deaf hoods, sisters and deaf hood brothers, and you fit in both communities, the hearing of which is the sign language interpreters, and then the deaf culture as to be, the deaf hood brothers and sisters. Among that tree, so you branch into those two languages where you become vocal, where you become, you sign as well. So you learn. We've learned sign language. We went to school for sign language. We wanted to fit in the community so that, we can speak for ourselves. We can speak for our parents. It was amazing to be in the sign language culture as we grew, because we could find our identity, and then we became parents. We have coders, and then we can teach our coders, and we're still teaching them, and we're still learning from other interpreters. Even though we have verbal language, Tsonga, Xhosa, Zulu, we multitask, and we are also teaching our children to be children with those hearing communities, to play with them, because we are not deaf as their parents, their grandparents are deaf, so we didn't have that resentment that our parents had for us. So we are letting them out to the community, but they also know their background as well. The spouse as well, because it's a hearing spouse as well, they know our background as well. We became to volunteer for the deaf people, the deaf community, as well as the hearing community, because when the hearing community, they host community meetings, our parents can be there, and then we interpret, and then that's when they understand. They don't mock us anymore. They learn, they are eager to learn, they want to know this language. Some will say, teach me. I wanna know, Kana, what are they saying when they say thank you? Yes, Sheila.
So, Mantobi, we have about 2 minutes more, and I really love hearing all of your journey. It's been a real joy to meet you. When we met before the first webinar during the rehearsal, we had a wonderful conversation. I look forward to more. So if you can wrap up in 2 minutes, because then we're gonna have our groups, so that everyone can share.
That's a wrap.
Hearing your wonderful Kona from South Africa journey. Yes. And so please continue. It's beautiful how you're explaining your Kona South African journey.
I think let me wrap, because I was about to wrap, because I still want to learn more. I still want to, get myself involved more with the deaf culture, more with the Coda culture. And I feel that I'm in the light, I'm in the right path. And then slowly but surely, I am getting there, and I will know my identity. I will be a double pride Coda.
Wonderful, wonderful. So double pride is my concept. I haven't yet explained. I'll try quick. Two worlds, hearing and deaf, means I have pride in both my deaf side, my hearing side. That's the goal, is what I call double pride. But I can't hammer my thumbs up and every day feel double pride, because every day it changes depending on my experiences and my journey with both worlds. Sometimes I'm very proud of my deaf world. I'm embarrassed of my hearing world. Or sometimes when I was a teenager, proud of being hearing, but deaf parents, oh, when teenage often are embarrassed if parents are different. So the goal is double pride for all the generations. So I hope we can help maybe have a signing family camp for South Africa and support your signing families to be happier and share with all your relatives. So now we're gonna move into the groups. Betty, do you want to talk about breakout groups for half hour?
Yes. Okay. Yes, thank you. I've just shared the questions quickly on the chat. If you can see the questions for your breakout groups. So we have, and now I'm gonna open up the breakaway groups and then you can join. We really didn't want to specifically say, assign groups to participants. You are welcome to, to join any group. And I hope you can see the groups on your screen. Can you see them? If not, I can assign them. Maybe it will take time to ask each one of you which group do you want to belong to, but seeing that we have about 20 participants, which is mostly coders, and I see Kristen, who's a teacher. I would probably think she'd probably want to join in the deaf and deaf of hearing group, and then I'll assign coders.
So Betty, I'm gonna encourage that we consider my suggestion is that the deaf group meets and I will have all the hearing of hearing in my group with hearing of deaf.
Okay.
Can we do that?
Okay. Let me.
And then there'll be other CODA groups, because I think it's important that every identity group have a chance to share with each other. It's very important. If we had a big hearing of hearing group, we would have their own group. If we had a big deaf of deaf group, could have their own, but I think there's just a few.
Okay, I'm doing the assigning quickly now.
Thank you.
So you can, as I assign you, you can join in.
So this is a time for each of in your group to take turns. You have to divide 30 minutes. Maybe you have 8 people to divide 30 minutes. Then please come back after half hour and summarize few minutes what you discussed in your group. In your group, we will have brief summaries and then wrap up.
I can't hear.
A mango. Mama, a mango.
Okay.
Mama, a mango. A mango.
Okay.
Huh?
Okay.
Mama, a mango. A mango. Mommy, a mango. Mommy, a mango.
Okay, I'm going to give it to you, Nana, please. Where is it? A mango. What is it?
A mango.
Okay. Show me. Wait, you want a mango?
Ashley, can you please do it? Because I'm working from home. Yeah. So I'm on a 30-minute break. I'm afraid that, so I'm in Teams meetings. So I'm consulting with clients. So I'm afraid that maybe while I'm giving feedback, there could be an incoming meeting request.
Yeah, of course, of course. I know that I have until 8:30 because I also have work.
Thank you so much, Ashley.
Yes,
so you'll be our reporter.
Yes, yes.
Hey, Kumbi, good afternoon.
There you are. Hi.
She just sent message in.
Okay, since we have a few minutes left, maybe you can say one word of how you feel about being a CODA.
Okay, I'll go? Mm-hmm. All right. For me, it's been a journey of self-discovery and also acceptance. I think our experiences, we can resonate with each other's experiences, we can relate. And Sheena mentioned something also important, that you sometimes feel ashamed. You sometimes feel caught between the two worlds. You want to be in the hearing world, but at the same time, you have to be in the deaf world because it's a part of you. It's not always easy to strike a balance between the two, but the older you grow, it's the more you are able to strike that balance. And for me to achieve that balance, it had to start with self-acceptance.
Yes.
You know, accepting that I was deaf parents, it's a part of me. Mm-hmm. And who knows, maybe there could be someone else who could be deaf also in the family.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Who would like to share next? Thank you.
I think for me, it is self-esteem. Mm-hmm. Self-esteem.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Confidence.
Yes. Yeah, confidence.
Confidence. Yeah.
So I find out that most coders get to start making decisions, life-defining decisions from kid.
Yes.
You asked, actually, person when I just joined, you were asking, did he grow up signing? Most coders did grow up signing, interpreting, I mean, for their parents. Up until today, parents in Nigeria prefer their children to interpret for them. I'm not sure about other countries, but in Nigeria, you see deaf parents wanting their kids, no matter how small the kid is, the moment the kid can do this, then yes, he can sign. He can sign for me. He can do this. He can interpret. Then you see the kid making decisions in the house. When there is a knock on the door, they just go open and then what you want to see? Dad, you know, they start making decisions in the house. So it's, for me, I think it's build confidence and always making these decisions. Self-awareness also.
Yes.
Yes.
In the US as well, I was interpreting as a toddler and still interpreting now, even though we have interpreters. Parents still feel that. I think it's the trust, and it might just be easier. We might feel more comfortable because we understand them, but yeah. Okay, we have, oh no, we're going to go into the other room now, I think. Yes? I thank you all for this very healthy conversation.
Yedari, welcome.
Yes. Oh, look at standard time. Oh, it's echoing. Oh, okay.
So, Mantombi, anything to say?
Nako. Oh, I thought that Nako was, greeting, because I think he or she struggled to come in. Can you all hear me? I think I'm muted. Am I muted? Oh, no.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, okay. You can hear me. Okay. No. In closing, I can say that light, you know, I feel like I was in the dark, you know, I was confused and not knowing where to go, you know, back or forward, you know, sideways, you know. So now I'm in the light, and I love the light that I'm in. I'm fitting in the light. You know, the light is glowing and blooming. And I've been patient, and I feel that being patient has given me a passion to be in this light. So looking forward to be in the light, all the way forward to the light.
That's a very beautiful way to put that.
Yeah. I was struggling to join, Ashley. I'm sorry. I don't know if Puto did mention that is my brother. He's so shy. So he obviously didn't say anything. And
Mandom
is quiet about it. Joseph, did you know that?
Yeah.
You know that Puto is my brother, right?
No.
Yes. Remember when I say the lawyer in the family? That's the lawyer.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, how cool. Small world. Yeah. That. Hi.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you soon. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
So, Joseph, are you Joseph from Nigeria? Happy to see you again since 2018.
Yes.
Rhode Island, your first CODA conference.
Yeah.
Shock. Yes. Now you have experience in Nigeria. I'm so curious, for 3 years.
Yeah.
Happy to see you.
Same.
Betty's here now, and we have 15 minutes left, or 10 minutes left, and Betty will take over to wrap up.
Okay.
So maybe, Betty, we don't have time for the summaries.
No, we don't have time for that. But then quickly, just to say that if maybe we can have, you know, any volunteers who want to share what they participated, so it could be 2 minutes each group. We have about 10 minutes or 1 minute just to wrap up. Those who've been identified to give a feedback can do that now.
So
I'm just gonna start, like, you can go, anyone, any takers can go and start to give a feedback. Sheena, can you stop sharing the screen?
Okay.
The screen share, thank you.
Hi, this is Bumi, and I'm deaf. I was in a deaf group, so I had Ronell. Sorry, he froze. I was in a deaf group, and we did share that we all had become deaf later on. We were born hearing and then became deaf at some point. I was ill. Larry just lost hearing over time. And at age 13 was deaf. And then Ronell had sign support or was in an accident. And that caused the deafness from a coma. And Ronell and I, we had similar families. They were hearing families. And
Larry
was a little bit more complex. There was hearing family, but then the grandmother ended up losing her hearing, becoming deaf, and siblings have started losing hearing. So there was more deafness in the family. And so he came from a mixed family. We talked about the experience of being deaf, but it was varied. It was varied, but at the same time, the journey with the trauma was very similar. Our experience of marginalization was similar, trying to find a place to fit in, and identity, that struggle was very similar. So that's a quick summary.
Thank you, Bumi. Can you go to the second person?
Hello, good morning, I'll go. So I was part of the CODA group. And so it was really interesting. We're all from different parts of the world. One person's in the morning, one person's in the evening, and one person's in the afternoon. And I think what was really beautiful is we kind of ended with, you know, the sentiment of like, what word would you have for the feeling of being a CODA? And across the board, it was along the lines of, you know, self-discovery, acceptance, and confidence, and going towards the light of just the beauty that we have of living in three different worlds of being a CODA, hearing, and deaf, and how sometimes it can just come up all in one. So maybe, you know, we don't have to separate that because internally it's in within us where it comes to the acceptance, self-confidence, and discovery as well. So yeah. Since we're short for time, I can go on and on and on, but we'll save that for another time. Just really appreciative of this webinar. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much, Ashley. Can we move to the that group?
Nancy, you want to summarize your group?
Oh, yes. There was three of us. Oops, hold on here. And we did share our experiences coming from hearing families. My brother-in-law was in my group and he did share about his family. He has hearing parents and shared that he had just discovered from a second cousin that they connected through 23andMe, that DNA testing, and discovered that they did have another deaf person in their family. Prior to that, he was unaware. And he was sharing that his understanding of his deafness was because of his mother being ill during pregnancy. So they thought it was based on illness. And it's the same thing for my husband, because they're brothers. They thought mom was sick during pregnancy and that's how they became deaf. However, with this newest revelation, we found that it's genetic. And apparently, so their mother's grandmother's sister, Bob, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, but in any case, he had a great aunt who was deaf, and this is brand new information for the family, so it seems like it does run in our family. And then there was another person, Atta was her name, and she shared her story about being deaf from illness, but she also did learn that there are also deaf members in her family in their lineage. So that's some new information that we all just learned. Very interesting to know about your history and where you come from. And that's what our discussion was. And then Bob shared his artwork. And it was sharing what his journey was like as a deaf person with hearing family and sitting at the dinner table with all the mouths around him and not being able to follow along and feeling quite left out. Mm-hmm. And that was part of his artwork, and he did it on a birdhouse. Beautiful work. Yes. Maybe Bob will be willing to pop in and show it to us.
Bob, can you join? Awesome. Can you show?
Yes. Can you see me? Yeah, absolutely. Right here.
Wow.
So this is what she was just talking about.
Wow.
The table.
Beautiful. Wow. Wow. Thank you.
Bob, do you want to talk a little bit maybe about your family history that you just learned about with your cousin?
So we just have 1 minute Sorry, we're almost 3 minutes left. We have to stop. Summarize briefly, please. Just short.
Yeah. I could do that real quick. From earlier on, you know, Sheila was talking about the family tree and, you know, that there are some deafness that have happened. And I thought, you know, we did not have any other deaf, but found out my mom's cousin, just had no clue until about a month ago. And a brand new discovery.
Wow. Beautiful to use the birdhouse. Many creative ways to express our journey, to help us see ourselves, plus respect the different experiences inside, to work together, be strong together. Okay, I think, Betty, you need to wrap up. I think we've got a good summary. Why don't you take the time to wrap up and let people know what might be happening in the future?
Yes, thank you so much. First of all, I just want to thank everyone who participated today. And, you know, thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. And this has been a dream for many years to see us as coders, hearing, and deaf people coming together, you know, in one platform and sharing our experiences and our journeys. So I just want to thank the two presenters, Sheila and Nancy, and also to the sign language interpreters, most of them are coders. Thank you so much, all sisters, and, you know, love. And thank you all. You also have the TMF board members here. Thank you so much to the friends of us. We love you all. Our colleagues, we appreciate you. So if we can turn on your cameras, if you can, we just want to see all your faces, you know, just to share the love.
Get a picture, a photo. Sheena, can you take a photo?
With your permission, can I get a picture of you all if you want to be on the picture? Can you just turn on your camera and then we can take the photo and we'll share it on social media as well, just to share the love and the work that we do and to spread the gospel. And just to quickly say to those who are really interested in embarking on this journey, we can offer you training with a subsidized fee, which would start in November, and it will take six months. And it's mainly not a formal training, but just to work with your inner parts, to work with your journeys, and in that way you'll be given guidance to do that. I know that in Africa, internet access is very expensive, so that can also be subsidized to buy you internet so that you'll be able to connect into this, you know, a phenomenal work that Nancy and Sheila does. And, you know, just to share quickly that Nancy also mentioned that there was an invite from South Africa for her to come and share her work. So I guess, you know, everything happens at the right time, and what is meant to be happens at the right time as well. So love to you all. And really, if you want to reach out, you are welcome to do that. Reach out to me. I can share my email address. And also, we'll have
sending out an email, right?
Just hold on, Sheila. Thank you. I will send out a survey after this webinar. We have a survey sent out to all of you. It's mainly just to, you know, check what have you learned from this two interactions. And also, if you would want to participate in future trainings, please let us know. So we really appreciate you being here, and love to you all. Thank you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Kristen, it's good to see you. Thank you. Oh, mama. Bye.
So, Obi, who is that?
My mom just came in. She brought my daughter back. She says that she was a babysitting and now it's late. She bring the baby back and she found us in session. So she wanted to say hello and bye.
My dad and Mantombi's mom, they went to the same school. They went to the same school, and my dad used to tell us that Mantombi's mom used to bully them at school, but not in a bad way. Not in a bad way, though. So it's just lovely to see her here.
Hello, everyone. How are you? And thank you. Thank you for this day. It's a very special day. I'm so excited. I'm so happy. far from South Africa. Thank you. So this interaction is really, really warm my heart. Thank you so much. I just saw Lumi's father as well. Please pass my greetings to him. Thank you so much.
Wonderful.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. And bye.
Kids, all the kids.
Bye. So I'm gonna turn off now. Bye bye. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Coders from Nigeria as well. We're here. We thank you for joining, Coders from Nigeria. We appreciate you. We'll have more of this. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye
bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.